The Word of God says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is worthy of the praise of His people. I think it would just be befitting today for we, the children of God, to just stand to our feet and give the Lord an old-fashioned Holy Ghost praise today that's due His righteous and holy name. Glory to God. Blessed be the Lord. What a mighty God we serve. Praise the Lord. Father, we enter into your place of worship today with excitement because you are the Lord. You are here, and we want to worship you in spirit and in truth. I pray today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, what a name. A name above every name. A name that is exalted. A name that is praised. A name that brings healing. A name that brings salvation. A name today that will bring encouragement. A name today that will bring strength. A name today that will bring deliverance. A name that is above every name. That name is Jesus today, and we magnify that name. We worship you. We come this morning into your house, and Lord, we thank you that you've given us the opportunity, the privilege today, the distinct honor to enter into your house of worship, to magnify your name, and to lift up our voices, and to lift up our hands, and to lift up our praises, and to say, yes, this is the day the Lord hath made. I shall rejoice and be glad in it. I pray that Spirit of God will just come down into this room today. I pray, Lord, you will shake us up. I pray, Lord, you will clean us up. I pray, God, you will deliver us up. I pray, God, you will just pour out your Spirit upon us. I pray the anointing will be so thick in here, the Shekinah glory of Almighty God will be so heavy. Oh, good God Almighty, it'll be like a fog hanging in the room. And Lord, that you will permeate our spirit. You will overwhelm us with your grace. And Lord, we will lift up our thanks unto your holy and your righteous name. Lord, save the lost today. Deliver those who are in sin. Set free those today that are in captivity. And Lord, lift up those today that are discouraged. And Lord, bless those today that need a blessing, because we're in the house of blessing. We're in the house of prayer. We're in the house of the Lord. We're in the house of deliverance. We're in the house of goodness. We're in the house where the favor is found. And I pray your favor will come down in this room today and be poured out upon your people in a mighty proportion. Oh Lord, we love you. We thank you. We honor you. We glorify you. We lift up you. And Lord, may your will be done here today. To God be the glory. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Give the Lord another praise, for he is worthy to be exalted amongst his people today. Hallelujah. He's a great God, isn't he?
We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy.
in the house of his people. Amen.
God sent his son. They call him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and he died just to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there, and it proves my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river. Fight life's final war with pain. But then, as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory.
praise the Lord. You know what you need to do, don't you? Shake hands, hug necks, and tell people you're glad to see them. Well, praise the Lord. God is good, and we're so glad that you've joined us today here at Gethsemane Baptist Church. And you know we serve a mighty and great God today. I pray that your heart is gloriously, mightily blessed of God. And today you've got reason to shout the victory. I want you to stay tuned for the message today. We've got something really good for you. You know, you may go through some problems, but aren't you glad you got a God who'll take care of every need? Amen. Do you know today there's nothing too big for the Lord? Do you know today He can solve your every issue of life? He can heal your body. He can encourage your heart. He can meet your needs. I mean, I could stand up here and talk to you all day about what our God can do. Stay tuned for the message today, because we're going to bring it all into focus and let you know today, friend, He's got something in store for you that's going to bless your socks off. Come worship with us at Gethsemane Baptist Church, 411 Blue Ridge Street, right here in the heart of beautiful Lynchburg, Virginia. And we're not hard to find. We are an exciting church, and we're not ashamed to praise the Lord. We're not ashamed to jump over pews and run aisles and give God glory, because He's a great and mighty God. I want to encourage you, come worship with us. We're easily found, one block off of Lakeside Drive. We're near the main entrance to Lynchburg College, 411 Blue Ridge Street. That address is right there on the screen. Drop us a line. Let us know if you enjoy the program, or let us know of any prayer requests that you've got, so we can keep you in our prayers and in our thoughts, and knowing that God will supply and take care of your every need. Well, we're going back to worship, and I pray today that the message, the music, and everything accomplished today truly will honor Him and bring good to you today. Again, thank you. I'm Carlton Duck, pastor of Gethsemane Baptist Church. We bless you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
And all my love is through Him. He punched me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Well, I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again.
I got three other people. I said, I believe that.
Amen.
Listen, y'all. Y'all got to get with the program. Y'all acting like a bunch of dead people today. We're not having no funerals here today. No funerals here today. You hear me? No funerals here today. We serve a great, mighty, and awesome God. Let's go back and sing that chorus one more time. Hi, good to see y'all this morning. Isn't it good? Amen. In Jesus. Come on now. Let me hear you singing, Robert. Come on. Oh, you're pretty. You ought to be in the choir.
Yes, he sought me and he bound me with his redeeming blood. He led me ere I knew him, and all my love is due.
In the house of the living God. Amen.
I'm waiting on you, Lord, and I am hopeful. I'm waiting on you, Lord, though it is painful. Patiently, I will wait. And I will move ahead, bold and confident, taking every step in obedience while I'm waiting. While I'm waiting.
Deuteronomy chapter 6. You know, life at times seems to be a constant struggle, doesn't it? Especially in these days in which we're living, there seems to be times, and life at times brings us loneliness, and it brings us a place of rejection. Life at times kind of leaves us feeling in a position the world has told us that we're worthless and we have no value. Life at times can bring conflict in the home where there's difficulty and struggle, and parents and kids are going through some times and challenges in their life. Life at times can cause you sometimes to even wonder if God really cares. I've had people tell me, "Preacher, if there really is a God." And I've just gone through this tremendous trial or struggle or problem or whatever it may have been. You know, where's God in all of this? I promise you, He's there. He's there. If you'll look closely, somewhere, as a songwriter wrote, you'll see Jesus standing. And there He's got His arms around you. You don't even feel it and don't even recognize it. You know, life sometimes will even push you to the point that you'll feel like grabbing the white towel and throwing it in the circle and giving up. And in these days in which we're living, I tell you, it's very easy to do that and to have that mentality. But, you know, you look at all these things, and I could go through another list of things today, but looking at all this, so where are you when it comes to endurance? Where are you? Are you one in a wind of doubt or difficulty or problem or pain or situation or whatever life throws at us? And if anybody told you when you got saved, all your problems were going to be gone and melt away, they told you a lie. Because Christians have problems just like everybody else has problems. But aren't you glad this morning that we got a place to take our problems? Aren't you glad that we got a problem solver on our hands? Aren't you glad that we got one we can look to, trust in, and know that He never fails? That He's always there? Hallelujah. You know, from the past couple of weeks, I've been dealing somewhat with this issue of God being a promise keeper. And His pages are filled with promise after promise. As a matter of fact, I've never gone through and literally counted how many promises, but I've been told that there are over 3,000 promises in the pages of God's Word. That's pretty awesome, because those promises are all applicable to you and I. We can receive the promises of God, but there are conditions of receiving it, even to the point that if you will come to God, I'm glad He said He will in no wise cast you out. I'm glad He offers salvation for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. I'm glad I am saved today. I am so glad I'm born again. I've been listening to all the dialogue and rhetoric that's been going on in the political world. I've been listening to what has been happening economically. I've been watching what's been happening morally. I've been seeing all the things that this world basically is hurling and throwing at us. And boy, I tell you, every day, Ken, it makes me glad I'm a born-again Christian. It makes me glad that I'm blood-washed. Amen. Richard, I'm glad I'm a child of the King. And I'm glad what God's given me and put in me, nobody can take out of me. And I'm glad I've been delivered, redeemed, washed in the blood, name written in heaven. And one day, I'm going to see that great land and that great city that God has prepared. But until I get there, I'm not going to give up, throw in the towel, and quit. And I'll tell you, the devil knows what it takes to take your rubber band and stretch it. But you know what? A rubber band's no value until it's stretched anyway. If you think about it, the rubber band laying there on the table and in your desk drawer or whatever, it's of no value until you stretch it, until you put some pressure on it. And that's what it's called using it, utilization. You know, God will use that in your life if you'll let Him do it. And today He wants to work in your life, but you've got to be willing to let Him work. So realizing this today, God is a promise keeper. And to us who believe, the promises of God then become a treasure chest of the unsearchable riches that God has. You know, it's hard to really discern what those unsearchable riches are until you open the treasure chest. You've got to get in the book so the book can get in you. You got to study the Word of God. You got to live the Word of God. You got to speak the Word of God. The Word of God has got to become everything that you're about. I mean, it becomes consuming. I mean, that you're so consumed with the Word of God, with the devil throwing everything at you, including the pots and the pans and even the kitchen sink. Thank God you got a shield of faith that protects you. Amen. That's the Word of God. When the devil is coming with an onslaught of opposition and difficulty and trouble and pain, hallelujah, you pull the sword out of its sheath. And hallelujah, if God then be for me, who can be against me? Amen. Think about the possibility that we have contained in the glorious treasure chest of God's Word. Then there is that unspeakable joy that is for the person today who knows how to search out. Amen. And really to find those nuggets of gold that are contained throughout the pages of God's gold mine called His Word. Amen. See, you're a lot richer than you thought you were. You're looking at your bank account and saying, oh my. You better look at your heavenly bank account and say, praise God. Amen. Amen. Because you got something here today that cannot be shaken nor removed. This is settled in heaven. God has already proclaimed it. God has already written it. God already wants to perform it in your life. Amen. Amen. So realizing this today, the promises of God are what we could call the Magna Carta today of our spiritual freedom. And see, God will work in your life if you'll just simply let Him do it. Hallelujah. Let me give you some points here. One today, God has promised peace in the midst of the storms of life. Peace I leave with you, Jesus said. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You know, when the winds of adversity are blowing in our lives today and the night is dark, it is Jesus that proclaims, be of good cheer. Hallelujah. Your sins are forgiven you. He's overcome the world. Listen today, friend. You can be of good cheer because today you've got a God who's put His peace within your being today. Amen. Not only that, God has promised today to be a great physician. Amen. Jeremiah said of the Lord, for I will restore health to you and I will heal you. Praise the Lord. That means we've got a great physician today that can take care of our every need. If you've got a physical need today, I'm glad this great physician, the healer of heaven, Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who is our healer, with His stripes we're healed. He's in this house right now. You didn't have to make an appointment, hallelujah. And the bill's already been paid. In full at Calvary by the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank God He not only will blot out your transgressions, He will heal, as David said in Psalm 103, all your diseases, amen. So I know doctors today tell us, well, you got and you're going to get and you're going to have to this and you're going to have to that. But Jesus said, you're healed. See, you got to start speaking the Word of God against your issues of life, your healing that you need. I happen to believe today that God can heal your body. God can heal your soul. God can heal your mind. God can heal your relationships. God, see, He's just not limited today to just saving you. Today, He can take care of everything in your life. And He can even take care of your relationships. If your home needs healing, He can heal your home. If your mind is all messed up, mixed up, and all torn apart, He can heal your mind. If your children are all messed up today, He can heal them. If y'all hung up on drugs and everything else, He can heal you. Praise God. If you got an alcohol addiction, He can heal you. If you got anything going on in your life, He can heal you. I believe this great healer is here right now. I believe He just wants to take and move something on somebody today. I believe He wants to touch you by His power. I believe He wants to heal you with His grace. Amen. That's what our God can do, and that's what our God will do. So He today is not only in the fact that He is at peace, He's not only today a great physician. Thank God, I'm glad He's here today. But also God has promised protection. You know, Psalm 91 and 11 says, He shall give His angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. Amen. So you have an invisible escort with you today greater than the Secret Service of the United States of America. Amen. You've got Him with you. You've got Him for you. He's watching over you. And thank God today, no weapon, as Isaiah said, that can be formed against you can prosper. Thank God you're covered and you're protected today. Amen. Let me tell you what. Nobody can take out of you what God's put in you. And today, I don't care what the theologians say, and I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what the television preacher says. I don't care what the book writers have written. I don't care whatever anybody or whenever, wherever. Today, if God said it, God meant it. And therefore, today, what God's put in you, you are protected by Him today. And so realizing this today, you have a great God watching over you. And if God then be for you, who can be against you anyway? Amen. Then God has promised provision. I love this because it says, but my God shall supply your every need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus our Lord. Oh, there's not a need that you can have that He can't supply. I'm glad today He can take care of everything. And listen, even He takes care of the animals out on the hillside. He takes care of the little plants that need watering. And brother, listen, He takes care of us. He supplies our every need. He watches over us. He's always on time with whatever He's brought to our lives today. Amen. God also has promised joy. Some of y'all could get a little dose of that. Some of y'all need a little bit of a Nehemiah experience. The joy of the Lord is your strength. You're walking around all humped over and all messed up and defeated and discouraged, and the devil's giving you the sourest look. I mean, it looks like you've been baptized in pickle juice. Amen. Look like you brush your teeth with vinegar. Well, I wish I could get my joy. Well, God's already given you your joy. You just don't recognize it. Romans 15 and 13 says, now the God of hope fill you with all joy. Fill you with all joy. Fill you with all joy. And peace in believing that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Now, God's also promised us a home in heaven. And I'm going to deal a little bit more on that tonight. But I will tell you what Jesus said in John 14. He said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. In my Father's house are many mansions, and when I saw, I would have told you, I go and I prepare a place for you. And if I go and I prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Let me, heaven's not some figment of your imagination today. It's a real place. Glory to God. I'm going there. My name's already recorded there. I've already got a mansion, and my name's above the door. Oh, praise God. And so that being the case today, praise God, Jesus Christ, you know what? We've got a promise here. Not only has He said today that we have a home in heaven, but He also today has given us the promise that He is coming again one day. I said He's coming again one day. And praise God, Jesus is about to appear and we're about to disappear. Amen. Praise the Lord. I saw a program on television recently, and it's really entertaining somewhat, called the Carbon Arrow Effect. Anybody ever seen that? That magician, you know, I tell you, it is, some of the stuff he could do is pretty out of this world. Well, let me tell you what, I got a Jesus who can do something greater than he could ever do. Hallelujah. I got a Jesus that redeemed my soul and wrote my name in heaven and promised me that one day in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, I'm going to leave this world and I'm going to be walking where I was walking on cobblestones down here. I'm going to be walking on a street of gold up there. Amen. And no magic tricks about it, my friend. Let me tell you what He's secured and provided for you and I is real. Not some optical illusion. Not something today that is messing with your mind. It's something real that lives within you today. Hallelujah. And one day we're going to gather in that great city of God and we're going to see Him face to face and we're going to be dancing all over the street of gold. Preacher, I'm not a very good dancer. He'll show you how to dance when you get there. I promise you. Amen. Hallelujah. I just believe today that He's about to appear and we're about to disappear. Amen. And all that is possible because God has promised salvation. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you're not saved, you need to be. You're going to miss heaven and go to hell. You sure you really want to do that? Are you sure that today you want to sin away and wind up in the fires and the pits of hell? See today, well, preacher, I've been a good person all my life, and I'm not a bad person, and I do the best I can, and I've been to church, and I've been baptized, and I've been this, I've been that. Have you been born again? Because if you have not been born again, it's of no value. You must be born again, Jesus told Nicodemus. You can't get there on your good works. You can't get there on your good looks. Most of us wouldn't get there on that anyway. Except maybe Jack, I don't know. But anyway, I tell you what gets you to heaven. It's the blood of the Lamb of God that was shed at Calvary's hillside, where Jesus died and gave up his life that we could have life and have it more abundantly. Let me tell you, you need to check yourself out here today. You need to examine your heart and make sure that you're saved. You need to make sure that you one day came to the place. I didn't say go back 50 times and you got saved. You don't need to get saved 50 times. You don't need to get saved 2 times. You just need to get a good, genuine Holy Ghost dose on the first time. And I promise you, if you'll come to him and ask him to come into your heart and your life and forgive you of your sin of rejecting him and all the other trash that comes with that, he'll forgive you and wash away your sins. And today he will redeem your soul and give you the promise that you now are a child of God. And being a child of God does not give you a right, hold your flaws, but it does not give you the right to go out and live any old lifestyle and treat God any way you want to treat him. It's time we stand up and be the people that God's called us to be. And if we say that we're saved and we're a believer and we're a follower of Christ, then bless God, live like it. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You know why people are having trouble? I can't live the Christian life, Pastor. I just can't resist that temptation. You haven't been born again. It's your problem. You've never given your heart to Jesus. All you did was came and say, well, I'm sorry about all this mess in my life. You've never genuinely asked Jesus into your heart. Amen. You've got to be born again. The only defeat that sin can have is Jesus Christ in your life. Amen. You need the power of God. The Word of God in John 1 and 12 says, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that will believe on his name. See, you've got to get your sins under the blood. And that doesn't mean you've got to keep running back and sin again. You don't have to keep sinning when you get saved. Your desires change. Your want to changes. Everything about you changes. Even your countenance changes, because now you become a child of the King. Amen. The reading of God's Word. I know some of you sitting there saying, when are you going to read the Scripture? Right now. Deuteronomy 6. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land whither ye go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I commanded thee, or command thee, thou and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it. Do it. No, Jadavon, say, do it. That's not loud enough. Do it. I like that. That it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily, as the Lord God thy Father hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with what? Milk and honey. Hear, O Lord, the Lord our God is one God, is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. Praise the Lord for the word of God. God's promises are rich, precious, and they're given to us, but they came at a great price. What Jesus accomplished at the cross, and how the pages of God's word was written, and the great sacrifice that was given that we could have these promises, we should never take for granted. You can count on it after the promise, though. Problems always seem to come on the scene. Problems are part of life. Welcome to living. Understand what happened here to the children of Israel. We're not going to go back to the calling of Moses on the backside of the desert, where God spoke to him and told him what he wanted him to do. And He was a little rebellious at first, and God tooled him and got him in the position where he could use him. But we find as he went to Pharaoh and the things that happened, God crushed Pharaoh. See, the crushing of Pharaoh is a type of the crushing of Satan. Hallelujah. Do you realize today Satan was crushed at Calvary when Jesus said, "It is finished"? You say, "Yeah, but he's still going about as a roaring lion, seeking whom may he devour." He's crushed. He's crushed. He's crushed. Amen. Amen. God leads the Israelites out of Egypt. Egypt is a type of sin. We need to get out of Egypt. Well, I'm out of Egypt on Sunday. No, you need to be out of Egypt the other 6 days of the week too. Amen. The Word of God tells us that you're either a servant of Jesus Christ or you're a slave to Satan. And that's exactly the way the Word declares it. That you're either a servant of the Lord or you are a slave to Satan. And I'm going to tell you, sin will enslave you. It'll shackle you. It will destroy you. It will gnaw at you. It will absolutely bring you down to the depths of defeat, and ultimately it will drop you into the bowels of hell. That's what sin will do to you. So every time you sin, you think about the price that you're paying for pleasure, that you're ignoring God and pushing Him aside in your life when God says, you know, if you really love me, you will serve me. I mean, if He's really first in your life, you've got to crown Him first in your life. He doesn't keep doors down. He does not impose Himself upon you. He comes where He is welcomed. And we've got to welcome the presence of God in our life and desire for Him to do a mighty work in our living today. So we find that God led the children of Israel through the Red Sea, led them into the wilderness, and the wilderness became their problem. I mean, they really had a problem when they got to the Red Sea. They started the murmuring, the griping, and the complaining. I tell you, if I was Moses, I think I'd have used that staff on a few heads before I parted the Red Sea with it, amen. But I'm glad I'm not Moses. So the wilderness became, I'm not going to hit you in the head, amen. I don't have no baseball bats, so don't worry about it. The wilderness became their problem. For 40 years, Israel had a problem. 40 years, they wandered in the desert. 40 years, they lived in rebellion. 40 years, they kept sinning. 40 years, they wouldn't listen. 40 years, they were in bondage. And so in the New Testament, we find Jesus was led into the wilderness also. His was not for 40 years. His was for 40 days. Israel stayed in the problem for 40 years. I mean, 40 years of problems. Every time God gave Israel the chance to stop and to step forward in faith, they faltered and they failed and they went back to their old sinful ways. See, Israel had a problem. They still have a same problem today. Well, as a matter of fact, all humanity has that same problem. Because if you're in the world, controlled by the world, and your affections upon the world, you're in the wilderness. And the devil is leading you by the nose, and he's leading you down the path of destruction and defeat. Because you're not going to live like you're living now forever. You're not going to live in the body that you're living in. One day, they're going to roll you into a church or into a funeral home, and you're going to be flatlined, graveyard, dead. And then it's going to be too late. Now is your day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. Now is the day to get right with God. Now is the day to not only get right, but stay right. Amen? So, you know, you choose today, you choose the path in life that you're going. So from the wilderness, Jesus began His ministry. You know how He answered the devil when the devil came to Him? In the wilderness, He was physically weak, but you know what He said? It is written. It is written. You know what words we use against the devil when he comes at us? I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm just so tired. I'm just so weary. I just feel like giving up. The devil's just worrying me to death. It seems like I try to serve God. I don't know what I'm going to do. You wimp. Have you forgotten who plucked you out of the fire? Who plucked you out of hell? Who plucked you out of sin? Who put you on a solid rock? Who established your going? Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercy? Have you forgotten who God is? Amen. When the devil comes at you, just remind him, Listen, he says, yeah, but you know, you were pretty rotten in your past, weren't you, huh? Yeah. You lived a really sorry life, but thanks be unto God, my past is forgiven and forgotten and removed. But your present, let's talk about your future, devil. Listen, start using the word of God on him. Stop walking around in defeat. Nobody's going to feel sorry for you. Oh, they may put their armor. I'm sorry. Everything's going to be all right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. We patronize people in their pity and in their self-absorption of self when we really should say, you know what you really need? You need for Jesus to give you a good swift kick in the rear end, and you need to get back on track. You need to get right. Amen. You need to get your life right with God, and you need to stay right with God. You need to live right for God, and you need to be a testimony instead of being someone that's tearing down the work of God and bringing shame and reproach upon his name by your sorry, no count, good for nothing, sinful living. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, you say, well, preacher, I'm not that bad. If you're living for the devil and you're living in sin, you're living beneath the standard of God, and it's sorry. It's sorry living. It's a defilement to the name of God. And God says you need to get up out of that mess that you're in. And you need to get where I'm at, because I got a better day for you. Amen. Praise God. That's what he was trying to tell these knucklehead Israelites. But they wouldn't listen. Y'all love me, don't you? Uh-huh. The mighty weak. Jesus knew in the problem. Well, when you go downstairs and bite into that hot dog, you can just think it's me. Amen. Jesus knew in the problem, if you will stay with God's word, you will go straight through the problem. Some of you pitched a tent, camped out. You even got a campfire going, and you got hot dogs on the grill. Amen. Because you're camped out in your problem. You know, how are you dealing with your struggles and your problems today? Life is not problematically free. It comes with the turf. How do you view your problems? You know, can be the problem. How you view your problems can be the problem. So if you see yourself defeated, guess what? You are. You're living in defeat. You chose that. Nobody pushed you there. You made that decision. And if you see yourself victorious, then you will live victorious. Amen. It's your focus today. If you see yourself as a failure, then that's going to be your home address. That's going to be your little email address. If you see your life as hopeless, then today, you know what? This is the life that you've chosen to live. But you don't know my circumstances. I know a God that's bigger than your circumstances. Amen. Your problems will never be solved if you don't face your problems with God's presence and with God's promise and God's strength and ability to overcome whatever you're in. So how you react to your problems will determine how long you stay in the problem that you're in. When you disobey God in your problems, be assured, God will not fall apart like you do. God is a merciful, long-suffering God. But it doesn't mean heaven shuts down because you're having a bad day. Amen. Maybe if you would become more faithful and more obedient, maybe then today you could avoid some of the problems that you're in. Amen, preacher. Thank you, Carlton. God is not going to speak to you until you learn to obey him. God is not going to speak to you until you learn to obey him. You haven't gotten the last thing that he told you right yet. You think, well, man, I'm just waiting for the God to open this new door. He's not opening nothing for you until you learn to get faithful in the doors that he's already opened. You want a bigger blessing. You haven't even dealt with the little blessings I already sent you. As a matter of fact, you didn't even say, thank you, Lord. You say, is that all that is? Is that all you got? You better thank God for everything you got from him. Amen. Praise God. But you're never going to get to the bigger blessings until you learn to solve the little problems that you're in now. Did you know today every problem that you've got is solvable? It is. But it's not on your timing, it's on God's timing. It's not on your ability, it's on God's ability. It's not on your strength, it's on God's strength. It's not on your way, it's on God's way. And so realizing this today, you know what some of you need to get back in? You need to go back to school. You've got to go back because some of you are flunking Believers 101. Some of you are saying, what? You're failing the basic course in Christianity. I mean, listen, the basic course is praying. The basic course today is Bible reading. The basic course today is church attendance. The basic course today is faithfulness. And even the basic course includes your tithing. But preacher, I'm not a bull and I'm not a goat, so don't butt me. But you don't know my finances. Could it just be your finances are in a mess is because you've never learned the value of putting God first, even in your finances? Well, I don't tithe. Well, for God's sake, don't tell them you're a member of Gethsemane Baptist Church then. Because if you're not tithing, you say, oh my God, he would have to get on this. Might as well. You're robbing God. You better read the book of Malachi. Yet have you robbed me in tithes and offerings. But preacher, you don't know my financial condition. I know that, listen, you may have some financial challenges in your life. Have you realized today that this, where you listen to all the Get Help CDs and every administrator and thought and everything that comes from everybody that we can grab, how am I going to get my finances? You know what? God's got a plan for victory in your finances if you'll learn to follow this plan. Guess what it includes? Tithing. Putting God first in your finances. We've been doing that ever since we've been married, and we was doing it even before we was married. But I'll tell you, I'm like David of old. I've not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Amen. All right, I'll let you off the hook now. I'm just preaching you the truth. Preacher, I thought this was an encouraging message. It is. It's an encouraging message to get you straight with God. Amen. Each of us have a free will. And because of that, your free will, you know what? If you're not careful, it's going to cost you a whole lot more than you wanted to pay. King David declared in Psalm 40 and 8, he says, I delight to do thy will, O my God. You know today, Jonah, the prodigal prophet, he is called, disobeyed God, and it cost him. He wound up in the sea, and he wound up in the school of whales. Amen. But God's heard his cry. And God will hear your cry today. God dealt with the heart of Saul of Tarsus, and he changed his life on the Damascus Road. And he even changed his name. And he came to be one of the greatest writers of the word that God used, named Saul, Paul the Apostle. Amen. His heart was changed. You know what? God wants to change your heart. If he can change your heart, he'll change everything else about you. What had him bound up, tied up, messed up, consumed up in the past, let me tell you what. Thanks be unto God, it was forgiven. And now Paul the Apostle cries, I delight to do your will, O God. I find pleasure in your service. It's not drudgery. It's a blessing to serve the Lord. Amen. The purpose of your problems is not to discourage you, but it's to develop your life for Christ. And so it's in the problems and the valleys of life you discover, oh man, how God is and what God is and who he really is in your life. You will know that he is the Prince of Peace. And you'll know that you've been through a great storm, but there was a Prince of Peace who brought you through what you faced. You will know that he is the God of all hope. You know what? After you've walked through the valley of hopelessness and the valley of the trials and even the valley of the shadows of life, you'll find, man, he is my hope. He is my everything. It's in the problems today we can discover the very power of Almighty God and how that he can do what he does the way he does it, because he's still omnipotent. He's still omniscient. He's still in control. And he's still God. Amen. You can shout, praise the Lord. Because God is getting ready to solve your problem and take you to the promised land. Am I going to die and go to heaven? The promised land is not heaven. The promised land is here. God's got a better day for you than you're living today. God's got a brighter future for you today than you're living today. No one can ever go beyond today what you're in until you trust God to get you beyond what you're in. You will have daily warfare. But you know what? It's God who gives us the victory today. For our God is an awesome God. Our God is an amazing God. Our God is an abundant God. Our God is still God. And nothing is going to change that today. Actually, today you can view your problems as an asset, because that's the place that you are developed. That's the place that you grow. That's the place that you're strengthened. That's the place that God works in your life. And this is where you become strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Yeah. Amen. David didn't know how great God was until he faced the giant called Goliath. I mean, he was just a little old kid, a little boy, didn't weigh 98 pounds soaking wet. But boy, I tell you, if God is for you, that's all you need. Problems are the things that will make you today what you are to the glory of Almighty God. Stop falling in love today with your pains in life. Stop staking out your tents and where you're at and what you're in today. Stop playing the victim role today because it doesn't work. And start living today as what God intended you to. See, you are bringing shame on the reproach, bringing shame and reproach on the name of the Lord when you choose to be the victim. I've been the victim. I've been the victim through life. I had a bad cut. My rearing was bad. Everything in life is bad. I got no breaks in work. I got no breaks in the name. Nobody helped me. I didn't get through what I got through. You know what you're doing? You're just sitting on a little old stool and feeling sorry for yourself. It's time you get up, because let me tell you what, nobody could care. I read about all these folks who get on Facebook whining and crying and griping and complaining. Drama, 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 drama. Why don't you just learn to shut up and realize who you are in Christ? Nobody cares about what you're in. Thanks, preacher. Well, if that's what you want, grab your more Kleenex and keep on snotting and blowing and crying, because that's all you're going to get. You can rise above what you're in. Amen. God, listen, I challenge every one of you this week. I challenge every one of you Facebookers. I challenge you this week. Everything that you post on Facebook, let it be about God and how good He is. I double, triple, quadruple, dog dare you. Amen. Because out of your belly should be flowing rivers of living water. Amen? Praise God. I use the phrase, you can attract a whole lot more flies with honey than you can with vinegar. Praise God. So realizing this, let me hurry and finish. You're not the victim no longer. You just got kicked off your little pot. Amen. And you may not be able to stand today all that you're facing, but God has already stood it for you. He's already won your victory today. Amen. I'm glad today. He said, he who endures to the end shall be saved. Listen to what Paul said in Philippians 3. Brethren, I count myself not to have apprehended. I count myself to have apprehended. But this one thing, I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. So as the songwriter wrote, and I caught this song the other day, and listened to the four lyrics of it. There's not a victory without a fight. There's not a sunrise without a night. There's not a purchase without a cost. And there's not a crown without the cross. Amen. Amen. And the problems that you're in, God will give you the strength to get through what you're in. Moses said in Deuteronomy 6:23, and he brought us out that he might bring us in. Amen. You've got to leave Egypt, the world, and sin, and all the shackles that has you entangled and snared today. Let go of the world today. Let go of the addictions of the world today. If you've lost your joy, you know, David said, I've lost my joy. But you know what God told him? He said, I'll restore your joy, but you've got to come back to me. I'll restore unto you the joy of your salvation. And it takes repentance to restore you today. And if you have sin in your life, let it go. Let it go. Put it under the blood. If you've got problems that are haunting you from the past, put it under the blood. Let it go. And so today, if you have things in your life that needs deliverance, bring it to Him. He'll deliver you. If you want the promised land, then you've got to get out of Egypt. You've got to get your mind off of this world and get your mind on Jesus. God loves you. And God has the best for you today. Stop living beneath what God has for you. Your problem in life can motivate you today to a new level of accomplishment to the glory of God in His kingdom. It takes the challenges to change us to His glory. Amen, preacher. You will only get God's provision by faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. The answer is closer than you think. But you've got to be willing to come to the answer. Because He has already provided the answer. Jesus is your solution. And it's closer than you think. What the devil sought to destroy you with, God will use to bless you with. But you've got to be willing to bring it all to Him and leave it with Him. If He's going to solve your problems, you've got to get your hands off of it and give it to Him. You want solutions? There's only one solution, and it's the Savior. It takes the blood of Jesus to wash away your sin. It takes the blood of Jesus to redeem you. It takes the blood of Jesus to change you. And once He's made that change, He didn't change you for you to go back to where you were. He changed you that you could press towards the mark, the prize. Because, see, one day, as I'm going to preach on tonight, He wants to set the crown on your head and say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." You know, but once you're there, and if you have squandered away your life on this side, it's going to be too late. But blessed be the name of the Lord. Jesus has not come yet, and you're not dead yet. So you have another opportunity to get it right and put Him first. Would you stand to your feet? With your head bowed and your eyes closed, or you can look around, I don't care. God sees our heart, and that's all that's important. I want to ask you one quick question here. Let's get honest. Are you saved? Really? I mean, this is not between you and me. This is between you and God. Are you saved today? If you're not, I challenge you right now to do something. This is your starting point, okay? This is your starting point to getting turned around. You've got to admit, I'm a sinner, and I'm in need of God's salvation. That's me, preacher. I need to be saved today. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to come to you. I'm not going to drag you to an altar. I'm not going to do anything offensive to you. I just want to know how I can pray for you today. Carlton, I don't know that I know Christ as my personal Savior. Pray for me. No one's looking around. Would you slip your hand up right now? Anybody? I don't know that I know Him. I'm not sure that heaven is my home. I'm not sure I'm saved. Pray for me. Pray for me, preacher. Pray for me. Don't be ashamed to raise your hand. This is the beginning of your solution. You've got to give it all to Him. And it comes with first giving your heart to Him. Then maybe today you are a Christian. You say, "Preacher, I got problems that need solutions right now." And I'll raise my hand and say, "I need help that only God can give. Pray for me." Would you slip your hand up right now? I got problems. I need God's help. I got problems. I need God's help. I got problems. If you didn't raise your hand, you might be raising it next week, because I tell you what, none of us are going to get out of this life without Him. Amen. Father, we just put everything in Your hands right now. These altars are not for show. These altars are for deliverance. These altars are for blessings. These altars are for healing. These altars are for salvation. These altars are for the people to come and meet with God. I pray right now, Lord, even though we go through the fire, I'm glad we got a God who will deliver us. Would You start moving on the hearts of people right now while people are coming to these altars and the music begins? Lord, I pray today for deliverance in Jesus' name. I pray for the Spirit of Jesus just to fall in this place today in such a proportion, in such a way that, Lord, we will leave here changed by the power of Jesus' name. You come on. He's calling. He's calling. He's calling. Will you answer the call?